Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.
Good evening and welcome to Heart to Heart. I'm Dave Spector, glad to be back. With me, my buddy, Dr. Andy Waxler. Welcome, we're glad to be back. We can't take phone calls yet. I don't know when it's gonna be. The sooner the better. We're gonna let you know as soon as we can, but tonight we're gonna talk about atrial fibrillation, and we're gonna talk about John Fetterman and the fact he had it. And
we're gonna talk about atrial fibrillation, and we may mention a public figure, but we will be politically correct and not say anything that will get us in trouble. And we can't be accused of a HIPAA violation because I don't even know the guy, and I just am reading what's available on the internet.
Right.
Through the magic of Google, or as they say, there's a funny movie where they say, I know how to work the Google machine. So, David, I know how to work the Google machine.
Good. Atrial fibrillation basically is just your heart losing rhythm, correct?
Yeah. So I should tell everybody, David and I talked before the show, and we decided, let's talk about atrial fibrillation. We have talked about this before. But it is so important. David, let me give the audience like a two-minute sort of summary. Atrial fibrillation is an abnormality. It's not normal. It's a dysfunction, an abnormality in the rhythm of the heart. Your heart and my heart is an electrical organ. When you look at the lights in the studio here, we can turn the lights on and off because we can flip a switch and the electricity tells the lights to go on. In a similar fashion, you, David, me, and all of our listeners and watchers, I guess that's redundant, have electricity in their heart to tell their heart to squeeze. So we do have electrical current in our heart. There are about a half a dozen ways where the electrical current can go haywire. One or two of them are life-threatening. Atrial fibrillation is not life-threatening. So I have good news and bad news when I talk to patients. When I say to a patient, you have atrial fibrillation, I have good news and bad news. The good news is this is not life-threatening. The bad news is it's very dangerous and can cause a stroke. Atrial fibrillation, David, is extremely common. Approximately 5% of people over the age of about 60 have it.
I thought it was higher.
Well, and it's about 10% above the age of about 70 or 75. Okay. And it might be higher. Those numbers are from a few years ago. Atrial fibrillation is increasing, and you're right. The numbers may be higher. So it's at least 5% for people around my age or David's age, and about 10% of people who are older. And it may be higher. But the point is, it's very common. It's increasing in incidence as time goes on. Part of the reason it's increasing is because we are keeping people alive now that we couldn't 20 years ago. And it's like good news, bad news. The good news is we have better technology now than we used to have, and so people are surviving heart attacks and living longer with congestive heart failure, things that, you know, we can keep people alive longer. But one of the consequences is if you live longer with a sick heart, you might get atrial fibrillation. It's a trade-off. But the point is, though, what's important that we all understand is that atrial fibrillation is a common arrhythmia, number one. It's increasing over time for reasons we talked about, and there's other reasons which we can talk about. It gets more frequent as you get older. And the curious thing about atrial fibrillation, David, is I've noticed in my experience, it sort of behaves in one of two ways. In younger people, they get it once every blue moon, and it's very symptomatic. They feel terrible. I have a neighbor who's also a friend of mine who's had it twice. And both times he said he woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning and his heart was racing and he just was, the first time he was scared to death. And then the second time he was not so scared, but he was more annoyed because he knew what it was, but he was annoyed. The point is I'm in my 50s, people in their 40s and 50s, maybe into early 60s, it happens rarely, but when it does happen, it's quite an event. They don't like it. They don't feel good. They're scared. They often go to the ER. As people get older, not only does it come more frequently, the incidence goes up, but for reasons we don't completely understand, it's usually, not always, but usually silent. people as they get older no longer feel their heart racing when they go into AFib. Now, a lot of patients argue with me, especially men. I've had patients, especially men, say, that's a bunch of BS. I would know if my heart was out of rhythm. And I say, oh, really? What rhythm do you think you're in right now? And they go, well, I'm in the normal rhythm. And then I show them their EKG from 5 minutes before, and I show them, I go, I don't think so. And the point is, I'm not saying this to show you how smart I am, and I'm not trying to be a smart aleck. I want to make the point that oftentimes there are no symptoms, and it's very scary. It's very scary, and it's very unfair. We often say life is unfair, and David, my dad died at 37 of lung cancer, so that's pretty darn unfair. So you want to talk about unfair. But what's even, well, I won't say more unfair, but certainly up there, is when somebody ends up in the ER with a stroke and they didn't even know they had AFib. So atrial fibrillation can be silent and it can cause a potentially devastating stroke. Those are important concepts for us all to understand.
Are there any symptoms?
The most common symptom is sort of a pitter-patter racing heartbeat when you're not doing anything, right? So if you run up the stairs, your heart's gonna race. When I was a teenager, I used to take the train and we could see the train coming a quarter mile away and we would just run full speed to the train station and you know, your heart's racing for like 2 minutes. It's not supposed to do that when you're sitting eating a sandwich, watching TV or talking to your wife, unless you're watching the Eagles or the Phillies. Now, if you're watching the Eagles or the Phillies, all bets are off. But the point is, yeah, so racing heartbeats. But as I said a minute ago, a lot of times there are no symptoms.
But how can you tell if someone's got AFib when they come in and they say, I thought I had a racing heartbeat, something didn't seem right yesterday, and you talk to them and you go through and you tell them, okay, explain to me what you mean and how you felt, and I'm just kind of guessing from years of doing this show with you, and you're going to say, well, what were you doing for the previous hour or two? And what did you do after you had this racing?
Right.
And how did you feel? So, and give me some clues. Tell me what's happening.
So the answer to your question is, the number one symptom is racing heartbeats. But as we've already said, people don't always get symptoms. Sometimes people get more vague, non-specific symptoms. Like I have a couple patients that say they can tell when they're in the atrial fibrillation because they just don't have the energy. Like for instance, they walk up the stairs and they're just exhausted. So when people get older, sometimes they have more vague, non-specific symptoms like that. So the answer is, it's really hard to predict. So, and that's the scary thing about it is, it can sneak up on you, it can be silent. And that's why, you know, there's many reasons we preach that you need to see a doctor periodically, and we talk about a family doctor, not a cardiologist. It's the main reason to see a primary doctor every once in a while is to try to pick up those half a dozen or so silent killer things. High blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes, atrial fibrillation. There are things that can sneak up on us human beings. You know, you could be the smartest human being ever. You could say, I'm in touch with my body, but you know, you can get faked out. And so that's why you see your family doctor and he or she can listen to your heart. Now, I should mention that I'm on the board of governors in the American College of Cardiology. Actually, technically, my term just ended, but I have been on the board. And I've made the point that I think that we can really make a dent, David, by detecting atrial fibrillation early, like in the general public. Like in terms of what can we do to help the general public. You know, David, if we could pick up atrial fibrillation in somebody like you or me before you have a stroke, that would be a save. And I do not have Apple stock. So I don't want anybody to say that I'm just trying to make money here. I'm not. But I do believe that things like Apple Watch and these types of little gadgets will pick up atrial fibrillation in healthy, asymptomatic people. So see your doctor. Check your pulse. I have patients that have a blood pressure cuff. And a blood pressure cuff, obviously the main purpose is, duh, to check your blood pressure. But some of those blood pressure cuffs will actually check the pulse at the same time and it will say irregular on it. So see your doctor. Get one of these blood pressure cuffs. Maybe get, and again, you know.
But if you get a blood pressure cuff, make sure to use it on a regular basis.
Well, yeah, obviously, yeah.
Not obviously. Some people, they had some kind of incident or whatever, and their doctor said you should have one at home. And yeah, and it goes in the drawer, and that's
it. You're right. I mean, that, of course, David is right. But you know, use, if you're going to buy something, use it. But what I'm trying to say is, check your, even just check your pulse every once in a while. I've taught my patients that if you feel your pulse in your wrist or your neck, it should sound like soldiers marching. One, two, three. It should sound regular. If it ever is all over the place, like kind of like raindrops, just like, you know, or I like to say, you know, kindergartners at recess, you know, if it's just chaos, that could be atrial fibrillation. Now, you don't have to go to the ER. It's not an emergency, but you should see a doctor in the next couple of days. So for those of you who are watching this or watch a replay at, you know, midnight, don't panic if your heart's out of rhythm, but maybe see somebody in the next couple of days.
But if your heart's out of rhythm, or you're checking your pulse, or if you're checking your blood pressure and the pulse is, it's indicating pressure not right, or whatever indication they have, call your GP in the next day or two and say, hey, here's what happened. Let them tell you what to do or not do.
Right. And you had asked earlier, what would I do if somebody came to me, David, you asked, and said, yesterday my heart was racing and now I'm in your office today. Well, the first thing I would say is your heart still racing? And you might say no. So what we would do to answer your question is not only would I examine the patient, but I would do an EKG. What's an EKG? It's where we put the little stickers on your chest, we push a button and it prints out about 6 or 8 seconds of the electrical activity of your heart on a piece of paper. Now, the good news is we can see what rhythm you're in at that moment. The bad news is it's like 6 or 8 seconds, so it's a little snapshot. Now, if that shows you're in atrial fibrillation, then we say, aha, we have an answer. If it doesn't, then what we'll do is we'll have you wear a heart monitor. What's a heart monitor? A heart monitor is a little sticker on the chest. They've gotten better in the last 2 years. It used to be a pain in the butt because you couldn't shower with them and people did not like that. But now it's just a little sticker on the chest. You can shower with it. You can wear it for a week, 2 weeks. It's really no big deal. Nobody knows because it's under your shirt. A lot of times those things will discover that, you know, look at that. For 2 hours, the patient was in atrial fibrillation and didn't even know it. And so my point is that atrial fibrillation is a common condition. It can sneak up on you, and it can have devastating consequences like a stroke.
But it's not something to worry about because, yes, the potential of a stroke is not good.
Yes.
But you can drive yourself crazy going, checking your pulse every 15 minutes too.
Right.
You've got to be reasonable about it.
You don't want to make yourself a hypochondriac. Obviously, you don't. Listen, we all have busy lives. We have better things to do than, you know, I try to tell my patients, don't, you know, I want you to be a good patient. I want you to take care of yourself, but I also don't want you to completely lose your mind and, you know, not have a life because you're so worried. Dave's right. There's a balance. But all I'm simply saying to you is see your doctor every once in a while. If you or your spouse or your friend has a blood pressure cuff, check it every once in a while, not just for your blood pressure, but see if it says regular or irregular. Teach yourself to check your pulse. Check it every few days, every once a week. Just see. So don't make yourself crazy, but it is worthwhile to check every once in a while. And, you know, I already mentioned that the saddest thing is when a person shows up with a stroke, because we talked about the most devastating consequence of atrial fibrillation. There are others. It can do other things. But the worst thing it does is can cause a stroke. But, you know, you hear stories about people that know they have atrial fibrillation and refuse to take blood thinners or refuse to see their doctor. I will tell you, I'm 55 years old. I've been a doctor for 30 years. I've been a cardiologist for about 25. I now tell people, I treat people like adults. I say, listen, here's the deal. This is what you have. This is what's going to happen if you don't take your medicines. This is what I recommend. If you don't like what I'm telling you, we'll get you a second opinion. If you don't want to listen, that's your choice. I tell people, you're a big boy or a big girl, you're an adult, but if you're going to not follow the recommendations, then you have to bear the consequences of the bad event. And you know, you hear stories, David, about people that don't take their blood thinner, don't see a doctor, when they know they have atrial fibrillation. I mean, they know. And so they, a lot of times, have strokes. One of my favorite patients is a guy 20 years ago who had atrial fibrillation and didn't want to take a blood thinner. He was very polite. I still remember he said, "Dr. Waxler, I believe you. I just don't want to do it. And I understand what could happen." Well, about a year later, he ended up with a stroke. He was like my age now. I mean, now he's in his 70s, but he was like in his 50s, and I consider myself relatively young. Thank God he had a very small stroke with minimal residual. And he actually said to me, he said, "That's it. I will never argue with you again." And he's been doing great for like 20 years now. So listen to your doctor. If you don't like what your doctor says, you have the right to
If you're paying your doctor or your insurance company's paying the doctor for the visit, listen to him or don't go to him.
Right. Or, you know, if you disagree, that's okay, but at least have the conversation, right? So I have patients that say, "Well, I don't want to do this and here's why." And I say, "Okay, let's talk." Right? Let's have a conversation. We call it now, there's a new term, David, like everything now politically has to have a new terminology for everything. So in the last 5 years, they now call it shared decision making. What that means is the doctor and the patient should make a decision together. And I said, "Holy geez, I've been doing shared decision making for 25 years.
You're way ahead of your time.
How about that? I never knew there was a term for it." So shared decision making is good. If you don't agree, open your mouth, tell your doctor, speak up in the office and say why. Don't just leave the office and say, "Well, I'm not doing that." I mean, you can, it's your right. This is America. Last I checked, you still have that right.
But when something happens,
then it's on you.
And your doctor says, "Well, weren't you doing this?" You go, "No," and they go, "Well, duh."
I mean, it's on you.
It took me a couple years till I started taking a statin, and my doctor is very happy that I'm on a minimal statin right now. And I go, "Okay." But I'm taking so many other things that just becomes part of the routine.
Right.
But we discussed it.
And you know, and I get it. I get it because I'm a patient too. As my wife would tell you if she were here, I've been getting gout for over 20 years, since I was in my early 30s. And I've been told for 20 years I should take this medicine called allopurinol, which you take every day, and it prevents gout. The problem is, in my 30s, I didn't want to take a pill every day, so I said, "You know what, I'll just deal when I get it." At first, I got gout attacks once a year, then every 6 months, then every 3 months, and then like every 2 months. And finally, my wife got kind of pissed off. And so anyway, about 8 or 9 years ago, I started taking allopurinol, and I've had one gout attack in like 9 years. So the reason I'm saying this is I'm preaching to you out there, but I'm guilty too. We're all guilty, right? You have to weigh the pros and the cons, and stroke is really bad. So I was kind of a jerk and didn't want to take the pill, but so I suffered. I would have gout attacks, and trust me, they hurt. But when it comes to a stroke, that's more serious. So anyway, I don't mean to be a preacher, David, and I'm preaching a lot, but I worry about people, and you know, I don't want people to have something that we could have prevented.
If you're not taking any pills for anything, more power to you, and you're doing good. But if you're already taking some pills, either in the morning or at nighttime or both, what's the big deal to take one more tiny pill?
It's there goes our producer, Joan. It's more psychological, right? You know, it's more of, "Oh my gosh, you know, I'm only 55 years old and now I'm taking three pills." It's a mental thing, right? And I get it. All I'm saying to you is I don't want you to have a stroke, right? And again, the worst thing is if you didn't have a chance. If you didn't have a chance to protect yourself, it's not your fault. If you had a chance to protect yourself and you chose not to, then I feel bad for you, but you know, you had the opportunity. And so that's what I preach to patients in the office is, look, let's fix what we can fix. There are certain things that we have the power to prevent and certain things we don't. We can't cure ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, right?
And they just had a special observance this past weekend,
right,
in baseball.
Right.
And ALS for Lou Gehrig.
And you're right. But what I'm saying to you is that there are certain things that we can't fix and certain things we can't prevent. But by gosh, let's fix what we can fix. And that's really what it comes down to. So if you have atrial fibrillation, if you have the diagnosis, not everybody, I should mention, David, that maybe 10% of people don't need a blood thinner. There are some exceptions. The vast majority, at least 90% of people with atrial fibrillation do need a blood thinner. So you need to talk to your family doctor or your cardiologist and say, do I qualify for a blood thinner? And if you do, I would go on it.
If you do, go on it. It's like, how? I mean, we're not talking giant pills, are we?
Yeah, there's
okay.
Small pills.
So you're taking one more pill.
So the thing of it is, there are a couple issues. Number one, the pill is a blood thinner. And so if people have recurrent internal bleeding, like let's say a person's had three bleeding ulcers where they needed blood transfusions, or let's say, God forbid, the person fell and hit their head and had a bleed in their head, this becomes a problem because we don't want to put that person on a blood thinner.
But these should be things that your doctor is discussing with you in this shared decision.
Shared decision making, very good, David. That's correct. But the point I want to make to you is that that's an important thing to discuss. Now, here's where it gets really interesting, David. Until about 8 or 10 years ago, we only had two choices for somebody like that. If somebody's got a high risk of stroke, but they've also had recurrent bleeding ulcers, we're kind of stuck. We're damned if we do, damned if we don't, because think about it. If we don't put you on a blood thinner, you could have a stroke. If we do put you on a blood thinner, you could have a bleeding ulcer. You know, kind of like what I say to patients is, geez, you as the patient and me as the heart doctor, we're kind of stuck here. But there is a solution. For the last 8 years or so, there's been this neat procedure called a watchman, kind of like a night watchman, like a security guard. This watchman procedure, as I said, it's not brand new anymore. It's probably 8, 9 years old now.
Yeah, we talked about this.
We did.
To you regulars out there, you heard us tell you about this before.
Yes, we did. And here's the 30-second story on what's a watchman. A watchman is a minimally invasive procedure where, not me, I don't do it, but two of my partners who are pretty good at they have pretty slick hands, they're pretty talented at doing cardiac procedures. They go up through the groin, through the vein in the groin, not the artery, but the vein in the groin. They go up into the heart and they can place a little thing that looks like, almost looks like a little parachute. It almost looks like the thimble on the Monopoly. You know when you play Monopoly, there's like a little sewing thimble as one of the characters? It's this little thing that can be implanted over a wire from the groin, right? So it's not open heart surgery. And it sits in the left upper part of the heart. It stays there the rest of your life. You only need to be on blood thinners for 45 days after the procedure. And then once we clear you, we see you after 45 days, we can safely stop your blood thinner. So what I tell patients is, if you don't go on a blood thinner, you could have a stroke. If you do go on a blood thinner, you could have a bleeding ulcer. With this watchman, you have your cake and eat it too. It is a procedure. There's small risks. The procedure takes about, I don't know, 90 minutes, and we keep you overnight. So it is minimally invasive procedure. You have to stay overnight, but the risks are small, and then you're all set for life, for life. It's a beautiful thing. And right now, insurance will only pay for it if you really need the blood thinner for the AFib and if you have a reason that it's dangerous, recurrent bleeding ulcers or blood in the head, or as people get older, when they start to get wobbly and fall down a lot, because frequent falls is a risk factor for falling and hitting your head. So something to think about. It's just another weapon, another tool that we have to fight stroke. Very important. Stroke is such an ugly, bad thing. You know, you just, trust me, you don't want it. It's not good.
And if
I would literally rather drop dead on the floor than have a major, devastating, debilitating stroke. A small stroke, I could be okay.
Quick review, symptoms on a stroke.
A stroke is sudden confusion or slurred speech. Weakness of one arm or one leg, so weakness of one side, 10 out of 10 severe headache. These are sort of some of the, you don't need all of them. So confusion, slurred speech, can't think of the right word to say, which of course we all get a little bit of that because as we're getting older, but I'm saying like, if you're suddenly totally confused for no reason, slurred speech, can't move an arm or a leg, 10 out of 10 headache, you need to go right to the closest ER and get checked out, whether it's St. Joe's or Reading.
Call 911.
Yeah. By the way, the Watchman is done, I'm pretty sure it is done at Reading, but I can tell you my group goes to both hospitals. My group has always done them at St. Joe's, and I will brag, this is a brag, my partners have turned St. Joe's into a center of excellence for the Watchman. So it is done in Berks County, something to consider.
Now, I know we've talked about something they do through the wrist. Watchman can't be done through the wrist?
No, Watchman is a little bit bigger.
Okay, but I know there was something we talked about in the past.
Well, what's done through the wrist now is a heart catheterization.
Okay.
So heart catheterization is where we look at the heart arteries. That's done through the wrist. The Watchman is done through the groin, the femoral vein. But again, it's minimally invasive. The wrists are small.
You come in one day and you're home the next day. Assuming there's no complications or problems.
Yeah.
And this is something we always talk about.
Thank God we've had next to zero in like the 5 or 6 years we've been doing them. So we've had one or two, I think. We've done several hundred. So I don't know the exact numbers, but I can tell you the risk of complication is very small. That I can say.
Are GPs now doing EKGs as a matter of fact for older people like over 50 or something
like
that?
That's a good question. And David, I don't know the answer to that. I don't know if when you go for your 6 month or year appointment to a GP, you get an EKG. I know they should put their stethoscope on your chest and listen. Whether they do an EKG, I don't know. I don't know.
Okay, because that would seem like
A good idea.
A good idea, even though it may not show anything, but it might show some.
Part of the problem is, we doctors don't get to make decisions anymore. The insurance industry does, and the insurance industry may not allow it. So I don't know. The GPs have a very hard job,
And they're cracking down on the amount of time they can spend with patients.
Yeah, I have tremendous respect for primary care physicians. They really do have the ladies and gentlemen in our county that do that are very good, and it is hard. So the answer is I don't know the answer to that question.
That's what I can't say enough good things about the GPs in our area, and speaking personally, there's a lot of caring caregivers out there in the hospitals.
Yeah.
And if you ever have to go in there, be nice to them.
We are blessed that we have two outstanding hospitals in Berks County, and I am biased since I'm a doctor in both, but I'm also a patient, right? I mean, I've lived in Berks County for almost 22 years, so it is true. We do have good hospitals. Every once in a while somebody will have a bad experience, but you can't win them all, but I can tell you it could be a lot worse. We are blessed. David, can I just say one thing?
Sure.
My Phillies are all of a sudden off the life support, and they're looking a little bit better. Certainly better than your Braves.
Excuse me?
Yeah, I'm just kidding.
And you're how far behind us now?
David lives in Berks County, but is a Braves fan, so we try to tolerate him.
We take shots at each other. Folks, we're sorry we can't take calls. We hope you keep watching us. We're on again in 2 months. We're on the second Wednesday of even numbered months. So we're on again, this is June, we're on again in August, whatever that second Wednesday is.
I should put that in my phone now.
Yeah, and hopefully.
Looks like August 10th.
Sounds good. We look forward to, hopefully you're watching, you care, and hopefully we're answering some questions for you.
Everybody have a great week, a great month. Go Phillies, go Eagles.
Have a good summer. And thanks again for watching us. As always,
I'll give you a nod.
Take care, man.
We're so political and modern.
Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.